Welcome back, everybody. We are up and live again with another tutorial for IMVU. And in today's tutorial, as you might have seen the title of this video, which is about making and modeling a Star Wars sword. It's a really good idea to actually begin learning how to animate your accessories, as we said in our last video. But before we begin, we have to make sure that we have also a good reference of the sword. I keep looking, you know, around the internet for a good looking sword, but it seems like they're all the same. So all I cared about to pick is a closer look of how the lower part of the sword is. So I got picture that I have, which I'll load up here in 3D Max, which is going to ease my modeling techniques and how can I approach the looking of that sword. So to do that, with your mouse wheel, click it in that front view and hold down Alt and B together, which is, this is actually going to only work in 2012 and below that. If you have 2013, it may not work because for some reason they took that feature off 2013. So back here, so you're going to, with this viewport background, all you got to do is pick the file or the picture you want, which is I think is in my downloads. Let's see here. And it's here. And once that load up here, all you gotta do is you go for match bitmap, click that once, and then make sure this is locked, zoom and pan is also checked, and hit OK. Here is the look for the sword bottom that I wanted to make. And despite the look of that one, because this is going to be very easy to model, which is, we will learn how to do that also today. And it doesn't really matter the size of the sword, because we can always adjust that once we bring the IMVU character in. So let's go ahead and now hit G on your keyboard to take the grid out and have a clear look of the sword. Again, moving the view around by holding your mouse wheel down, and then you can just move it anywhere you want. And zoom in and out is not going to affect the plane. It's not actually a plane, it's just a background. So I'll come here with, says my perspective view. So we're going to have to make a slender. So you're going to check left click once, and at the perspective view, left click and drag, which is going to give you the radius of how big or small the cylinder is, and then release the left click, and here you will control the height. And it doesn't really matter how high, like I said, we just can, you know, manipulate that as soon as we get to the character of IMVU inside here. So I'm just gonna do it just about here and go ahead and maximize the viewport and left click here once, and then go ahead for edge faces turn on. Notice here that this here is way too much polygons. All these lines, each one of these rectangles that create the whole shape is considered to be a polygon. Again, if you want to start something in 3ds Max that has to deal with IMVU, it's always a good idea to start with way less poly than it really is. Because if you start something with 5, that's way too much. Then by the time you get to model it, I will teach you guys how to do that, but by the time you get to model this, it'll be like headache moving all these lines back and forth. So I will take down, which says high segments. I'm going to take this down to actually 1, which is nothing going to be here. And then go back in here, which says maximize viewport one more time. And I will try to focus here to get like a closer look of the bottom. I have here, let me see. So what I want to do is, like, I gotta do one line here by the bottom, and another 2 here, and keep repeating this all the way up to here. This will be very challenging to get the results like you see it here, but just to ease your work, we're probably gonna have to ignore this part here and just make it this all one plane. So to do that, you can come here, which is modify panel, right click, editable poly. Now you have converted your cylinder to something that you can actually adjust and modify. So go in here to left click once, which is edge, and by the side view, which is the left view, you get a closer look by zooming in, but with your mouse wheel, and left click and hold and drag over the side plane or the side lines here, which is going to be all highlighted in red, meaning that you already selected these. And you come here with sys connect, which is going to be for the setting as well. And notice if you move this to the side by hold down left click, see it says 1 here, but you come at the bottom with the last parameter. You move it back and forth. You notice there's a line here that moves as you do so. Let's turn off the grid on this one as well. So you can see the line, that's where it actually indicates where we're going to place that next line on that, on all these lines. So this is just a slight bit off, so I'm going to have to make it like here. And we're going to have another two, so we'll left click again over the other two. But you notice here now it's been separated because we draw a line in the middle. And you go ahead and do this again, connect. And instead of this one, we're going to do two lines here at once. So you're going to come here for two lines. And this 70, right click once, they're going to set it to 0. And then you go ahead and shrink this down by taking this to minus whatever number. And take this down again to kind of match exactly with what we wanted. So I think that's just about right. Again, you don't always have to do everything perfectly, because IMVU, doesn't matter how precise you are in your modeling, it will never show how good the model is, because it always reduces the texture and always need a low poly. So we have done one here and one here. All we gotta do is like this is 4, this is 5 lines. We can just, first thing we need to do, we might just separate this part so we don't have to confuse ourselves. So right click once again just to get it to 1, and then zero out everything and make sure this is right on the top, just a little bit down here. That looks good. And for this one here, I might actually do, let me see. Okay, try to think of an idea. Oh, we already missed one here. So let's go ahead and do that too. By holding left click and drag over it, and then connect again, settings, and then we're gonna do two lines. This time, this is like really small, so we're gonna have to take this down. Sorry about this one here. And we're gonna push this up right before the edge. All right, and hit okay. And here, what we're missing is this one here, we've done it. There's the one here. So you might want to come here and over that, make sure this set all to be 0, just to make sure all the lines are set properly. The good part of doing this is you do 2 at each. Every time you do this, like if you did like, let's say, crazy number, you notice that they're probably all not going to be aligned properly. So to fix that, I would rather just do 2. Again, because you're going to save the same settings. So 70 minus 75, that looks good. And I'm going to take it down to be just about here. And you see that plus? You're going to hit that once. And all you have to do is left click and drag over this again. It will take it again for another one. Then all you got to do is like take it down again. So we have here 1, 2, 3, 4, I think it was 5. So let's go 1, 2, and we're gonna add the plus 3, 4, and 5. That's actually got a little smaller than it should have, but let's see if I can get this higher. All right, so I can get that way and have to push this up. All right, that may not be the goal. So I'm going to maximize the viewport again. This may not really be right exactly. So if you want to adjust anything, you're going to go for the vertices left click and left click drag over that line. And here, which is transformation or select and move, you left click that once and then go ahead with that Y axis, drag it up. I might even get this a little bigger, so I'm left click and drag, push that down a little bit, and do the same thing here. Okay. It looks a lot better. And let's see here. Well, I've done 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's perfect. Okay. So, but you notice here, if we get a closer look of our cylinder here, all of it flat. How can we get these edges here, like the outside edges? It's just really easy and simple thing to do. We want them all to be at the same height, so we don't want anything, you know, bigger or outward than the others. So to do so, you go for a maximize viewport, and you want to select the edges that you want to expand. So we're gonna come closer here. We actually want this one. So select by going to polygon, left click, and select one polygon. Hold on shift and do that. It will actually select everything all the way around. So let's go ahead and do the same thing here, which is we have this one, all of it here. And it's the same thing. You're gonna come a little closer and hold down control while you're selecting. Make sure to hold down control while you're selecting all the edges. Then hold down control, and while you hold your control, hold down control and shift to select the other edge, which is gonna add more selection to the one that existed. And then you go back here. Let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then let's go back in. And then we're gonna again hold on control, hold on control and shift, and click somewhere where we're gonna select the ring. Hold down again, control, shift, control, shift, control, shift, and until we select our edges. And here, what we have, let me see, we're gonna have 1 and 2, just only 2. So we're gonna select this one here and hold on shift and click, lift and click. So here so far we have got the selection pretty much that we needed. All you gotta do now is you come here with his extrude. Again, you're gonna go for the settings. Once that, it might seem, oh, that's crazy, right? No, it's like an easy here. All you have to do is change it from group to local. And that's way too big, so you're going to have to take this down here. Just about here. All right, just a little more. Yeah, that looks good. And then you hit that check and turn off polygon, and here we have it. Just in a matter of seconds, right? So to fix that top here, because we want to make the rest of the sword from here. So come inside here, we see it's polygon, left click once, select the top part. And you may want to do a couple things. First, I would rather just have inset, which is if you get a closer look at it, you're going to make another sphere, or another circle inside of this one. So let's go ahead and hit OK. The reason why I can't easily move this up and down was that actually affecting the entire ring, which is going to save my edges. So I can come here and go for the same extrude that we have done before. And here we can just take our height way up. Just about that here. All right. So they're going to be two parts. Remember that they're going to come up and down. And this is going to be a different part. But we're just going to be beginning with the modeling part at this point. So there's one easy trick here. You want that curvy looking edge, right? You don't want to have this to be flat, because it never been about the Star Wars sword to be, you know, way too flat like that. There's a few approaches here. First one is, let me show you that. If you go ahead and left click and for edges, draw a line, and then go ahead and connect again. And set this to all to be just one, and drag this line up just about here. Let me get it close so you can see it. If just about here, and you hit OK, let's come out of this one, and you select, this is actually shows you if this model was just smoothed out, how the result's going to be. It's just for the testing purposes. If you left click where it says use NURMS subdivision, and you click it, and then you notice here, you have this curvy, you know, unflat surface, which is what we needed. But again, it doesn't look right. So you have to turn off this again. And here we have to come with this polygon one more time and select the top edge. And we're going to do a couple inset. So we're going to be do it like, again, just use the plus and go. Here, all you have to do is left click once and take, let's go ahead and actually choose grow. And then here, then have two edges selected, pull them up. And then all you have to do is select that little one, the small one, and pull that up too. And here, we can just left click here with these edges, and then select this one here, hold on shift again, select again, again, that option, holding down shift to select edges, it may not work in 2013 and beyond that. For some reason, I don't know why they took it, but, and then you might actually want to take this down a little bit. And also, if you want to give it just a soft edge, all you have to do is come here for chamfer, and you can decrease or increase the amount of the smoothness edges here, which is going to take that one edge, turn it into two, just to get the nice curve on the side here, as you can see. I like this one here, so I'm going to keep that here. And I might just want to pull this up a little more. And then just to test out what we did, and there we go. You can actually see us a lot better now. Again, you don't really have to smooth this out unless you actually export it to IMVU. So part of modeling we already have done. And just to keep yourself in the right track, all you have to do now is to separate these two for a good reason. Because when we start building our skeleton for that accessory, this has to be a separate part from the bottom. Because that's the one that we're going to be moving up and down as we want. So you go back again, select the model, and go for left click on polygons. Left click and drag over the top part. And notice here, if you hold down your mouse and try to zoom in with your mouse wheel, that everything up that we have selected, which is what we want, we haven't selected any of these edges. If you have, make sure you go from like a wider view and make sure you left click and drag over that top part. And then here, all you're gonna have to do is you select detach. It will ask you for renaming. Let's call this sword underscore top. And now we can just also, just for being organized, just go ahead and rename this one from here. And we're gonna call this sword underscore lower part. And I can't see today. All right. So we have now two different parts. So the next part of what we're about to do now is that we're not going to use Photoshop today. What we're going to do is we're going to actually unwrap this part of the sword and that one. And then we're going to actually bake our map within 3ds Max. We're not going to need Photoshop. It's pretty much only one video in IMVU Education Center that talks about how it can bake textures. And it just, in this video, I'll just show you another technique that I use myself in most of my work just to get, you know, the good results within 3ds Max. The good thing about 3ds Max, you can set up lights, you can set up textures as you actually want in it, and it will give you realistic results. And that's what we're about to learn on the next part. So we have already finished the detaching part, and what we have now left is the UV map, which is we're gonna do a map for our sword here. So once we're done with the coloring and baking textures, we're going to rely on the UV map that we already created, which is about now. So the first part here, we're going to get to use the top part because they're going to be the easiest just to get you used to the UV map. So left click and drag over the top part of the sword, and you're going to go for the modify panel. And you go down, left click once, and press U in your keyboard, which is you're going to come here, which says unwrap UV map.
And here are the projection presets. That's what we're going to be using on the top one. So you probably, once you select that, you'll have the vertex highlighted. You're going to click here once, which says polygon. And if you get a closer look, what we wanted to do when we use the cylindrical map, we're going to use these polygons and the one at the bottom, because from this point on, that has to be projected from the top, which is we will be using a planar. So you're going to go back and try to get a wider view, and you left click from the top here and go down. There's another way to do it. If you go here, open up the UV map editor, which is going to show you the map. All you have to do is you get a closer look at this and hold out control, left click in two polygons, and it says here loop UV. And you press that, it will highlight all the polygons around for you. Then you come back and you do the same thing here, left click, hold out control, and left click twice. Just make sure two polygons have been selected and go for the UV map. Okay. Okay, that's weird. This one. Maybe we can do three. Oh, wow. Anyway, then you left click and drag over that one. I don't know why it hasn't really selected it, but you just can manually do that. Until that square here is going to be centered. Which is, we're still missing a few polygons here. Let's see. I think that's all of it. Yeah, okay. So now, you're going to have to use the preset, which says cylindrical map. And once you do, let's go turn off. Make sure you turn off this, because you can't really move or do anything as long as this is on. So let's go left click once to turn it off. And if you notice here, if you can drag this down, this where the entire cylinder here is all about. It starts from here and ends here. And you can even tell if I select that right part with that blue line here that indicates it's the end, the actually detached or the part of this one. And notice here, if this part, there's the pretty much the top part, which is, let me get a closer look here. And if you left click here, this, notice it's going to be at the bottom, which is we need to flip this the other way. There's a couple ways to do it by going here. It says this rotation with minus 90 degrees and keep pressing it until it's right on the top. Or to undo that is hold out control and Z a few times. And let me see. And go here and use, let me see here, this map. Select, use flip for horizontal or vertical. But this is probably the easiest one because it gives you like a 90 degrees rotation. So we're going to go ahead and do that once. And we're still here. You have to left click and drag. You might even notice that part here is the top plane. So you go ahead and left click, drag over it. And while we're here, we're going to use the planar presets. And once we do, again, turn that off by left click it. And notice here, this is pretty much the sword map or what we want in it. Let's go ahead and just first, we have to take this down a little bit just to make it expand, just like the sword, you know, length. So by going here, which says free mode, and drag one of these, you know, rectangles by just left click and drag to get a, like a longer shape. And now we want just to get everything, when you do the UV map, you have to keep everything within that box, because this is how you're going to render your workplace. And you go ahead and left click in, over the entire thing, and you use the same free form mode, and by the dragging over that rectangle and then just shrink it down. It doesn't really matter how it's going to look like, but it's really a good idea to center it and make sure there's a free room from the bottom and the front at the top. And if you have something that going in the side, make sure also you have a room on each side. Because when you bake textures, you might find like a line between geometry that you need to fill in with the paint. Just always a good idea to keep, you know, just at least a few centimeters away from each side here. And then let's go ahead and just rescale this one again, just to look, make it look like a sphere. And there we go. And now we can just go ahead and close this now. And while we're here, we're going to right click and collapse to. So we have done the top part. The lower part is going to be a little bit challenging because we have so many different edges. And it's always a good idea to understand which face that you have to use the planar on and which face you have to use the cylindrical. So we're going to come here and do the same thing again, but left click and highlight it. Go with this modify and then left click and press U and go for unwrap UV map. And then we come back for polygons and get to open that. And let me just first, sometimes you have to be very careful when you begin doing the UV map because sometimes it freezes. It just kind of bug in the old version of, you know, 3ds Max. They haven't fixed it. So once you've done a step making something, always make sure you hit that save button just to, you know, to confirm saving for your project so you don't really lose it at any time if it crashes. So here you may notice that we have faces that already go facing down and up and facing that faces us, like here. This one we can use cylindrical on, this one also, and this one here, and this one here. However, if you look in this side, that's going to be facing up, so we need a planar. And so is the bottom part here, which is this. We're going to have to use the planar map for it. So the first thing we need to do here is we're going to go left click, hold on control, select a couple polygons, and we're going to go ahead and open that UV map. And if you look at this, it's like a mess. Like nowhere to find an actual polygon. But we're going to fix that. You're going to go ahead left click twice. And you're going to go for the ring, and it will select it for you. Again, hold on control twice, and hold on control and select two polygons, place on that ring, it'll select it for you. Now it's just working. So left click twice, and use the ring. I should hold on control. Okay, so we can just go ahead and begin doing this by, let's see. Hold on two polygons. For some reason, it's not really getting the entire selection. So I might have to do this kind of separately. Okay, it's holding it. Okay. So they might actually have to be away from one another for some reason. So we just gotta keep doing this. And if in case you just deselected everything, hold on Control Z and it will bring you back to what you have selected in the past. So again, hold on Control, select two polygons and hit the UV ring. And just go up, try to use another one here. Oops, that did not hold. Okay. So that's pretty much enough for this part here. And now we're going to go ahead and use the cylindrical map, which is going to come up here and again turn it off, make sure to do that, and then instead of moving you're going to use the freeform, left click and drag down, which is already have got some of these parts off the sword for us. Notice here this all straight up, you know, edges except this one here. But if you come a little closer, let me just expand this so you can see, if you left click here it will select that blue line here. It says this is really related to that. So to fix that, all you have to do is select that polygon here and come here down where it says break. And once you do, you can freely move this to that here. You can get a little closer just to get a precise move. And while we're here, you're going to go ahead and select edges, select one of these edges, and hit stitch to target. And do the same thing here. And it's always use that one that outer looks, it actually can have a straight line. So now we made this already straight line, so we can just move on to the rest. And to get a clear look of what you're doing and what you have really messed, you can see here, it say check patterns. Just select it one more time. And you will tell here that these parts, the one that has the straight squares, black, you know, checkers, that the one we have done. The one that has little tiny ones or the long ones that we have not done. So move back again to polygons. And we continue to see any of the selection here. For example, if you selected this, you know this is going to be here, so we don't want to play this, or we don't want to do that one again. So you're going to go ahead and move to other ones that we haven't done. So hold on control, double click in two polygons, UV map, and then the loop UV map, okay. And then just do the same thing here. And a little more. Hopefully it's going to hold that selection. And it's going so far. All right. And I think we're almost done with this. Yes, I think so. Except this one here. Just double click on two polygons and then use that loop UV map. And here we have done all the selection. So we can also do the same thing was using cylindrical and turn it off again. And then come back here and start placing this to where we should be. So to get a clear look of what all this has to look like, you can either move it manually, which is what I prefer. That's going to be in the top. That's going to be the one lower. So we're going to just move it closer. It doesn't really matter how precise or exactly this is, as long as it's in the same line. And this is what we're going to follow. And let's see. So we can just double make sure. Okay. So this one here will follow. And then we stopped here. And then this one, which is we may not really have done. Yes. Okay. Hold on. Control again. Double click in two different polygons. Use the loop UV map. And then go ahead and drag it in. That's kind of weird. I actually have not used the cylindrical, that's why. And then turn it off again, try to shrink it down. Again, you have to be very careful with what you do in UV map, because it might take a long time for you as you just begin using it. But it's always a good idea to keep, you know, your work in the low poly. This is why it will make, you know, your life much easier if you use a low poly than something really complicated. Because that's pretty much the most consuming part about making model in 3ds Max and using this bake texture feature. So we have done this one, that one, and we have done this. So we're going to move on to the next part. And this one seemed like we have not done it. Okay. And then we use the same feature. Use the cylindrical. Take it down. And it's a really good idea to have it all organized, because once you bake the texture, you didn't need to do anything else. The model will be ready for you to use. So, and this here, drag it up. Okay, we missed that one, I think, too. Yes. So, and then we can use the cylindrical, turn it off. I actually do it a lot faster because I'm kind of used to it, but you have to take your time with it always. In case you have mistakenly left a polygon over the other and you deselect it, notice if you try to select one or all of them, it'll be a mess. So you have to always use Control Z to undo your work. Just to get it, keep each polygon that you detach, it has to be in different area where you can select it freely. And I have to move these down just to get kind of clear look of it. And this one too. All right. And then I think this is, should be following the right one. Let me see here. This one. Okay. That one follows that one. Okay. It's also a good idea to keep your eyes on the polygons. Notice here, this one is right here. However, if I selected this one, it's somewhere else. So you left click here and highlight that part and turn it 90 degrees, which is going to be toward this angle. And now if I select it, let's see. It is still not really precise there. I don't know why, but it seemed the way that we have done the cylindrical, it wasn't precisely right. But that's fine as long as we get a big detection within 3ds Max. So we can move on. Let's see here. We finish this. We finish that. So we have to come to this one here and drag it up. Well, I'm trying to align every part of the bottom part of the sword to be exactly the same, and then we're gonna take them all at once just to align them here. So we miss another edge here and do this too. So yeah, that's pretty much gonna be the part that really takes the most of your work. Even if you're making clothing or accessories, this is what we're gonna be spending your most time in 3ds Max doing. So let's go ahead and move to that one. I think we missed that one too, yes. So there's gonna be a couple more until we get the bottom part. All right. Like, it's going to be hard for you, it might be very long, but once you get the hold of this thing, it'll be really easy. And I think that's the one. Okay, so pretty much that's the last part here. And again, we still have to get the, let me see, just expand this a little more. Just kind of matches a little bit. So we still have the lower, let me just show you this. If you use your cube here for the view, we still have this, and we still have these edges that we have not really done yet. And so is every other edge that back here or up. So we have to do that too. But it's gonna be the same process, which should be really easy. Hold on again by going to the polygons here. Two polygons while holding control. And then choose the loop UV. That one didn't work. Let's see. Yeah, I don't know why, but sometimes it works, some other time it doesn't. But let me see if I can use that one. I think that one kind of worked. Yeah. Okay, so we gotta be use grown ring UV instead of the loop UV map. So let's just continue with this and see where it's gonna go. And we have selected this part. Hold down control again while you're selecting two polys and just keep. That's really weird. Like, I'm not sure what really makes 3ds Max act in this way, but we can use this even manually, which is going to be a lot faster. So hold on control, just keep selecting these edges. And just to save ourselves time, we can just also select the top part by holding down control, remember that. And we can get all these edges at once. Keep selecting. And we're going to be using the planar on this time, and we're not going to be using cylindrical. The reason why these edges facing up and down, so but when you use cylindrical, it's going to mess up the whole polygon pattern. So you're always going to use the face up and down and see where exactly the edge is facing. Then we're almost done from the top part here, and then we got a few more here. Let me see. If you ever wanted to see this in clear view, you can always left click here and use wireframe. It will show you exactly how and what you have selected here, which is a really good reference just to see if you have missed any. And so far, we have really missed, I think. Alright, then we continue down here. Selecting. Let me see if I can. If I just drag this up here, I think we will be selecting every part. All of them at once, I think, because we have got the parts out. Yes, okay, we got a few parts that are missing still. I'm not sure why. Like here, it's always missing. So you keep selecting parts or the rings around the sword. You can't really select through the sword, you have to get the edges. So you continue selecting all these rings here. I think we got one more ring at least left to select. And it gets jumpy, I don't know why. But 3DS Max has been really full with bugs. So this is why I always recommend for you guys to save your work. If you have made a step, you know, successful step, always save your work because you never know when 3D Max decided to crash on you. And a few more left here. And this one too. And for recommendation, you can deselect the bottom part because this has to be separated. So hold on Ctrl-Alt while you're selecting, and that gonna isolate the selection. Like, you gotta isolate this part here from every other selection. And now I think we have selected all the parts that we needed. All you gotta do is use planar. It will take them all in one ring. Notice that here. And then you go ahead and turn off planar again. If you actually exported the UV map just like that, which is all these rings considered to be one, every texture that's gonna be applied, it will be applied to this one here. And it will be applied to every one of these rings, which is might be really easy because nobody gonna be like, you know, looking at the sword and try to see, oh, this part is missing. They're gonna receive shadows, which is gonna be pretty much black. So it's always good to keep all these rings at once, just all of them, you know, at the same color. While we have this part left, which is, I'm assuming, is gonna be the lower part of the sword, which it is, we're gonna use planar again. And then turn it off. And now we're going to have lift, click, and drag over that one. We're going to align it to the side. Take every other one of these. And also put them here just to get a clear look of what we do. And then here, we select everything. And then we're going to, using the same free mode form. Or free form mode. Okay. And then with the rectangle, hold on, lift, click, and drag. Just to scale it down, just align it with that box, maybe a little more just to get them inside, and now you can just start expand it to be matching with some of these edges, and that should be right. By turning off that, then we're gonna go right click and use collapse to, and here we have done the UV map part. What we have left is just using the texture, which is we're going to be baking first because once we move to IMVU avatar, we have to get all the textures ready. So what you have to do first is you select the top part, which is going to be the glowing one. But before we do, I noticed that the top part of the sword is a little thinner than the base. So to fix that, I'm going to have to select the top part, go for vertices, and here, I'm going to left click and drag, and I use scale here, and then I'm taking from the middle triangle and holding that left click and drag in, just to shrink that a little bit, and turn it off, and if I want to get a look of this, I'm just going to turn off the edge faces, and so far, it looks okay. Doesn't look so bad at all, and it doesn't really have to be a high poly, so it's really good. Now, you're going to go for Material Editor. And once you do, you're going to get that window. And here, we're going to go to choose our first material. And remember, now we're just painting or putting the maps and colors over the sword, and then we're going to tell 3ds Max to actually bake the texture on what we did here. So we're going to use a color, and that's going to be something like glowing light blue, which is, we can use that one here. You're going to go ahead, all you have to do is like click and drag over this. And in case you didn't get this window, all you have to do, you're going to get to the mode, and you probably, let me show you this actually. You're going to slate, you might actually get this slate material mode, which is going to be something like that. And then you, to turn that off, all you have to choose mode and choose compact, which is the much easier form of the material editor. And here, I think I have the sword. Let me see if I can. And in case you don't see also the material, the picture that we have uploaded first here, all you have to do is hold on Alt and B together, which is going to give you that viewport background, which is we already loaded in our the beginning of our tutorial. And hold on Alt B to open it, and all you have to do is hit OK. It's just going to load up the picture again for you. So here we have about one, actually pretty much like two materials, like black, or pretty much dark gray and light gray, which is we can do easily here. So going back to the viewport by holding down your mouse wheel, and then you go for maximize viewport, and selecting the bottom part of the sword, moving again to edge faces just to see what we selected. This is going to be much easier than the UV map, so it's going to be easy. Go for the polygons. Left click here once. Hold on shift and select the other one. And do hold on control again while you're selecting one poly. And hold on shift and control together to select more. And just keep doing this over and over. Hold on control again, left click. And while you're moving to the other one, hold on shift and click. Control down and click. And then hold on shift and control together again. And just keep selecting. I'm just going to try to move a little faster here. And here is going to be, we can actually go also for these. Alright, these might be a little different, so just not really do that yet. And then we can move to the second material here. And we can choose, there's a couple ways to do it. You can choose this by eyeball it. Just choose the color or the dark gray you want it. Or you can come back out here. And once you go for the material and you choose the color, see that pick tool, like Photoshop? And you can choose the color of the image. But a lot of times that the quality of the image being reduced by 3ds Max, so they can have it on the background. So I just suggest you guys, you know, do it manually instead. So I might have to get like a rare dark color just about here. And move into the second material, which is going to be the lighter gray, which is going to be something like that. And it doesn't really have to be noticeable. So that's really good. So I'm going to left click and drag over the polygon that I already selected and release it. And notice here, if I turn that off, let me just go ahead and also turn off the edge faces. It has selected somebody's part for me. Let's just go to maximize this. So it has already, you can probably can see the difference here between this and that one. So an easy trick here to do, this has already included two materials. To find out how you can, you know, get the other material item without selecting any other polygons, all you have to do is just go ahead for a new material. Use that pick material from object and left click it once. Here it will give you, for some reason, it's three materials. So this should be only two materials. Let's go ahead and see where the others. Okay, so now, all right, I see. They actually isolated also the top and the bottom part, which is, I'm sure of it. Can't see that one now, but we can fix that easily by going, let's go and turn off that. Go up here, which is go to parent. We have four materials here. We should have one, which is probably the one at the bottom. Let me just go ahead and just see if I can Okay, yes. So that's the gray, the dark. There should be the lighter gray, which is like that here. I think go. Make sure also show the material in viewport as selected and highlighted. Then go to parent again, and we can use the darker gray and all of the others. And let's go up. In case you want to copy this to the others, just without actually going in and just physically doing it, all you have to do is left click and drag over this. It'll ask you to copy a material use instance. And just do the same thing here too. And here we have selected our, we painted actually our sword. Then there's not much you can do after that than just bake the entire textures. So you go ahead and left click that here. And you're gonna go for render. And once you do, you're gonna go ahead render to texture, or you can use that shortcut, which is zero. But again, I'm trying not to use a lot of shortcuts just because of you guys learning. So I'm gonna use render to texture. And once that open, let's see why it freezes. Okay. And if this is not really, if the name of the part here is not there, which is you're gonna come here and add it. I'm sorry, not here. Should be. But what you have to select, let me turn it off T. Now, if you didn't select it, it will not show the name. But if you select it, it should show the name. So you go ahead and move down here by left click and dragging. You're gonna always use the existing channels UV because this is the UV map that we have done in the first place. And here, if you're not using, which is you're probably going to be using the default render engine for 3ds Max, so you're always going to keep this. You're going to go for add, and we're going to choose a complete map. For later on tutorials, when we use lighting, when we do textures for clothing, I'll show you guys how, because complete map is going to calculate all the lights, and if there's any atmosphere, effect. It will add it also to the texture. So for the purpose of this, I might just want to use 256 by 256. And other than that, we don't need to do anything than hit render. It will ask you for whatever errors this is here. Just ignore it. Okay. As I was expected, 3ds Max actually had crashed on me, and I forgot to save my coloring, my painting, and my project. But this is gonna be a good idea just to remind you that you can always save your UV map before 3ds Max crashes on you. So to do that, all you have to do is you go here, it says File and Save UV Map, and here you can just place your file anywhere you like. So I have mine in the desktop. So I'm gonna go ahead and desktop here and think IMVU. Just save it anywhere here. And I'm gonna call this Star War Sword. And then make sure to put UV map lower as it's a lower part. And go ahead and save it. And while we're here, you can turn off that and right click and hit collapse to. And also do the same thing with the top part. Let's go ahead and press UV map again. And go open the UV editor. And while we're here, you name it Save UV. And while we're here, all you have to do now is just change the lower to top. Save it and close it. Now right click again and hit collapse to. And make sure you save it. Mine has been, if you see here's auto backup that actually crashed. And to get your files in case 3ds Max crashes on you, all you have to do is get it open. Let me just go ahead and save this for now. And you go ahead and open. There's gonna be your folder. Actually, it's gonna be like that, which is your files. And you're gonna go for the auto back. It saves everything every 5 minutes or something like that. So I had three different version of my project, my last project. So you can see 1, 2, 3. So you're probably gonna have to make sure where was the last one. If you did something like painting, which is here, I did like some sort of painting. So you just go ahead and open it, and it's gonna be here for you. So to load up, in case you know you haven't done any UV map and you just still have that raw, you know, sword. To do that, you're gonna go for here UV map again, and open up the UV editor. And if it's not here, all you have to do is gonna go load up the UV map and choose where you save it, and it should, as long as you haven't changed anything in the geometry itself, it should be applied as fine. So I'm gonna have to do this again one more time by going to turn on, let me see, edge faces, and hold on control twice, and hold on shift. Yes, it's really 3ds Max is really full with problems, that especially with 2012, because pretty much like now I have sets of tools that I use for my own self, so I'm sure a lot of these will cause problems, but sure enough that yours will not really cause you that much trouble. So we can use that material editor again, and let's go and just something that I'm gonna be light gray, which is we can use it. And for these here, I'm gonna use the, let me turn off polygon and go for the pick tool and choose it. And then here, I can just go ahead and choose that dark color. Do the same thing, drag and drop. And then it says copy. I'm gonna go for instance and drag and drop and use instance. So now, I might want to do a little experiment just in case to see how it works, and I will come back if 3ds Max didn't really crashes on me. But because I'm sure it has to be some sort of lights. And let me see. Oh, okay. I see now why. I have a different render engine. For you guys, you shouldn't really have that problem. This is VRace, like a render engine that I use for myself. And because of the material are not really assigned to work with V-Ray, this is why I'm getting these problems. So I'm going to have to change it to be default. For yours, it's going to be the default scanline render, which is what you need to use. And just use that one too. And still, I just wanted to save my project just in case, you know, it crashes. So now, what we have to do is just render the material. So we will select in the lower part, you're going to go ahead and choose render, and we will choose render to textures. And as we select it, again, the name should reflect here. And you should always use the existing channel, which is what we have, that's why we have done the UV map in the first place. And add, and we're going to choose complete map. And we're going to come here 256. And other than that, you don't need to change anything. And it will give you that error, which is normal, and hit continue, and here it is. If you look at it, when we add more, like, you know, shiny materials with a light, it will does a really good job by painting everything for you. So now we have done this, which is pretty good. All you have to do is gonna go ahead and save the image, and let's go for the desktop file. And we're going to call this, we're going to be JPEG, and we will do this sword lower part. And we can call this just in case, it's going to be map. We go ahead and save it, and should be fine here. Now we're going to close that one now, and then you're going to go for the top part. While you still, if you don't really see it, you can always go ahead and turn edge faces on. They're gonna be easily showing you what you really highlighted. Come here again, do the same thing, and we're gonna go for render to textures. And while everything's set, just making sure all these always, you know, all these using existing channels is there. Add, and we're gonna complete map 256. And render, and here we go. This is actually might be way too dark for the sword, because the sword has should have like shouldn't really have any sort of shadows in it. In case you want to have a better lighting, which is I'm not really happy with the result when baking here. So it seemed like my scene has shadows on the top part of the sword because it's supposed to be glowing. So to do that, all you have to do is you're going to go for the create panel. You're going to choose light. And with photometric, and you're going to choose a free light. It will ask you, to accept that. It will do like, don't show that again, and said yes. And here, you can just drag and drop a light. And if you want to just see how this light reflect, then just hit render. Nothing yet, because we haven't choose the type of the light. I would choose like a 100 watt bulb. And it's going to be white. You always make sure, because this, if you change that Kelvin scale, notice the color will change. So you always want to get something like pure light. Like, white will be perfect one, so you can always make that to the max number. And what else you need to change here? Just keep on shadows. And you should turn it off because there's going to be a light, so we don't want to do anything with that. So don't turn it on. Let me see why it's not really getting any light here. I might actually want to raise this up. Oh, because this is way too low. So I'm going to have to raise this up a little bit. Maybe it will does give us a no still. If you want to see, turn off that and just see why there's no lights. Let me see. Should be some. Well, I did really change the light, didn't I? That's really weird. Spotlights. That should really give me a results here. I am not really sure. The intensity, this to show maybe this one. We can just raise this up just to give us. No, it's still really. Okay, we can try to see if it gonna work with the baking here, so we can go for render. And once you go for it the second time, everything should be the same. So all you have to do is locate render, and we'll ask you to overwrite, and then just go override it. Yeah, we don't really have lights at all now. So instead of using the photometric light, we might want to do. I think we'll probably use the target lights. Let me see here. Oh, standard. I'm sorry. Yeah, we have to go to standard. Oh my god. Yeah, we have to go for a standard and use Omni. And we just also have to go here and play with the settings a little bit. And while this on, you can always come here for the intensity. Just make it as much as you can. And you notice here, now it gives me your results. That's what I was looking for. So keep pushing, the light all the way up. And even if you want, you can, what you do is like you go ahead and hold on shift and jack to have two lights, which as you notice here, it gives you some really good results. Let's turn off that. And we can also have another two, one here, just to make the light even in each side. All right. And as it's supposed to be glowing, right? So you, again, select the top part here and then go for render to textures, and everything should be the same. Go ahead and hit render. Okay, that's way too much now. Okay, we can actually take this down a little bit. Let's see, for the intensity, I'm actually go for like 100 for each light. 100 and 100. 100 and another 100. Hopefully it's going to give me a better result than the solid white that we've got in the first place. Let's just do that one more time. It's still really too bright. So, I don't know. Can take this one to 20. 20. And you can always place this lighting that we're going to be using a lot later on when we make a room that we have like outside light coming in. And let me see if I selected that. Okay, here. We're still getting here something, so you might even want to take it down to 20. Let's see. I'm going to take it up to 2 here in each light. Because I'm just used to the other render engine, that's why 2 were probably way too low. Well, since we're using this one, so we can always, you know, experiment with the... There we go. That's a lot better. So I might actually save this here and make it JPEG. Go for what we said. We can just copy that. Just left click once and it's going to copy the name for us. And all we have to do is changing this part to the top and save it. So now we have done the big problem, the biggest part of, you know, doing that sword. So in my next part, we're going to open up the IMVU avatar file, and we're going to bring in the sword. And then once we're done with the sword, we're going to add a bone structure to the sword that we can actually move it. And we should really be able to animate it, and then we export it. So before we move on to IMVU file, we have to make sure that something here is precisely placed, which is going to be the two parts of the sword. And to do that, you select one part and you go here, let me see, which says heritage, and it says effect pivot only, and make sure the center to object. They're going to align the movement of this sword to the center exactly. While we're here, you're going to also left click and select the top part. Notice how far this is from the top part. And while this selected, just go ahead and also go this to center to object and turn it off. And also you need to do, while we're here, you're going to right click here, which says you make it all in 0, 0, and 0. And also do the same thing here. And okay, if you don't really have to do the 0 on this one, I think, or that one too. So you just want to keep this, the first two in 0. And this is that contain, that's actually indicates the height, how far higher your lotus is. So you can always turn off these here to be 0 out, and it should be fine, and it'll be right placed exactly in the middle. And we now go ahead and save as, and let me go and choose that into the folder, to this max and be a folder, and I call this Star Wars and Star Wars mesh, and then go save it. And now we can go ahead and move to this max with the IMVU folder, and we will choose, let me see, the male avatar. So we're going to open it, and I think that's the one that actually moves. If it's, yes sir, yes it is. Okay, now how to bring in the sword is by going here to that 3ds Max icon, and then go ahead and choose merge. But you're not going to click on that. You're just going to have your mouse over this. It'll give you a few options. We're not going to use the first one because this is to import OPJ files and different files that is not really related to 3ds Max. But we'll be using merge. And here, you can go ahead and navigate to your folder, which is going to be in desktop. And IMVU, and here it is. Then once that open, all you have to do is left click and drag. If it's not, you hold on control and select both, or you can just choose that all selection and then go ahead and hit okay. And the sword, once you open it, it's like nowhere to be found, right? Because it's really tiny, because the scale of the IMVU folder is kind of big. So that's why while you're selecting the sword, you're going to go for the scale or to select an uniform scale, and left click and drag the sword to be bigger, and then take it on the side here and just keep pushing this up. And see that little home icon? Just press that once and zoom out. And here you have a better result of the sword. Before we take this to the hand of the IMVU avatar, you have to make sure to build the structure or the skeleton for that sword. And that's what we're about to do. Press G on your keyboard to turn on the grid, which should be really tiny, but we can't see it. And let's go ahead and now, what we have to do is we're going to readjust a little bit of a few things here. Remember when we did the effect pivot only? What we're about to do here is the same thing, but we're going to have to keep the effect pivot only, turn it on, and then while we have the select and move tool, take this down to the bottom of the sword. And let's go ahead and select the top part again and also do the same thing. The reason why here we are making some sort of a base for our movement for the sword, because the sword gonna move up and down, so you just want this to be in a straight line. However, the bottom, which is gonna be controlling the top part, has to be also at the lower part of the sword. So now we're gonna go ahead and move from maximize viewport to we're gonna choose the front view. And hold on while you, again, holding and moving your mouse wheel, they're going to give you a different perspective here. So go ahead and maximize the viewport and get a little closer to the sword and go back to where it says create panel. And then we will go to helpers and make a dummy. And we have seen this in our first video when we made the hit sign. So left click and drag one, and left, all you can do is like hold on shift and drag. It's gonna make another copy of it. And for the hand here, we probably gonna have to make another one that could actually sit on the hand. So you can make just another one here. So the first one here, gonna go align with the sword. Just make sure everything has been centered. And then all you have to do is hold this up because they're gonna control the in or out of the sword while it's going, you know, in or out. So it's gonna be right here. And then this here gonna come at the center, but we have to also use a line just to make sure. Take this to the base or the area where both actually connecting, and that's gonna be where it's gonna hide. Or actually, you know what? You can actually take this a little bit down, because when the sword go in, it shouldn't be showing anything at all. So let's go ahead and take it even down further and have this one here. We're going to keep this away just for now. And here we're going to go for what we call skinning, which is we already have done also a few times in my first two videos. So let's go ahead and turn off the edge faces and also press G to turn off the grid just to have a clear look of what we're doing. And now all you have to do is to go ahead and now have, let's see, the maps load up. So select the top part, which is, again, let's go ahead and turn on edge faces so we can see. Moving on here to the second material, this is the first one that contains the avatar. Use the second one and go ahead where it says diffuse. Just click on that little box and choose bitmap. And let's go ahead and choose where we have saved our material. And remember, this is going to be the top parts, right? So you're going to go ahead and load this one here and rename it. We're going to go ahead and call this sword, or let's go Starwars_top. And then we're going to go space, brackets, number, magic number, 20, then close the brackets. And then hold on, control A to select everything, and then copy it, or right click, use copy, or you can use the control C in your keyboard make sure show shaded material and viewport is on. Go up to the parent, left click and highlight it, and then right click again and paste. It has to be exactly the same number. And we can go for the second material and go ahead again for the diffuse bitmap. We're going to load the second part and then we can rename it. We can use also the same way, Star Wars lower map. We just can go, let me see if what we did here. Okay, so we just lower and then take the brackets. Go ahead and make sure it hits space, brackets 21, close the brackets. Again, you can use Control A, copy, and go up, show shaded materials on, go up one more time, left click, right click, and then paste. And then all you have to do now is right click and drag that one in here and this one on the top. And then make sure also this is on, and this one also is on. And then now let's go ahead and turn that off. And it should, you probably can see that the paint here is probably different because we just load up the map. So how the animation will work, we're gonna actually come here and do, let's see. Actually, we might have a third node here that controls the base of the boss. Pretty much gonna be one that controls the sword, one gonna control the top, and one that gonna hold the top in its place. And that's what we wanted. So we're gonna right click here, hold on, shift and drag. And we can make this one, rename it here. There's gonna be the top _ sword control. And this one will be the base sword control. And that one here will be, that should be the base actually. Okay, we can just call this sword control handle. And this is gonna be aligned to the sword. Well, since everything has been centered, all we have to do is we're gonna take this down to be just about here. Just about here, because this is where the avatar is gonna hold sword, so this is where it's gonna be. Now, turn and open up where it says schematic view. Just turn that on. It will look really horribly bad, but I'll try to kind of make this very simple just for now. And now here we have to go for what we call linking or parenting. So it is going to be the base of our sword that will control these two. So you're going to go ahead and select this one, control it. I mean, left click here and hold. You're going to link that one to the base, which is going to be the father of all of them. And do the same thing here by left click and drag. And go ahead and go here for the father node. And if you come here again, let's go and expand this one more time just to show you. If you get a closer look here, there's the controlled handle. That's the one that controls both of them. And you can see that this relationship to the two is like controlling both of them. And you see the arrows that goes up. That mean these two are related to that. Meaning here, if I wanted to move the sword, I'm just going to have to move that node here anywhere. And you can tell that everything else follows. And that's what we want. And let's go ahead and now beginning with the skinning part. So you select the top part here. And you're going to go for the modify panel, which is here. And left click and hit SK to get the skin. And you're going to add. And while we're here, we're going to use the top controllers, which is we have made. And to see that, notice here, it gives you the controller is like the base that control both of them. And they're both underneath that. Like you can see, they just go into the side, and that's what we want. So you're going to go ahead and choose top, sword control, and left click here. And we'll see envelope, turn on vertices. And we only want influence on the top part of that sword because this one is what controls the top. So left click, drag over. Notice if you get a closer look at this, everything in the top of the sword has been selected and highlighted in white rectangles. And then now you're going to go ahead and come down here, which says weight properties. If this is 100, it's like 1%, it means 100, which is what we want, which is you don't really need to add or edit anything else on that. So let's go ahead and turn off by left click it, and let's go ahead and try now. If you come here and start to move, it'll actually be affected, but what we have left is this here. So you're gonna come at the bottom, and let me see. Actually haven't selected the bottom part yet. Okay, here we go. And then you go ahead again, left click with a modify panel, go for SK and skin. And while we're here, we're gonna have to control the top part. I'm sorry, we have to first go to the top again and add another controllers, which is gonna be the base controller. And while we're here, you're gonna go for edit envelopes, turn on vertices. And as we here, you're gonna come and left click and drag over the base vertices, which is they're gonna be whited, also just to make sure they are highlighted. And then come down here, if it's 100, don't play, or if one is here, don't play with it. And then now, if I want to move this, notice what happened. That's going to go down. That's going to go up. So, I think I'm not sure what's... Okay, that's good. And to keep that in position, what you have to do is you're going to press Alt and right-click over that. And you will notice here, which says Transform. I mean, Freeze Transform. It will ask you whatever that. Just go ahead and say Yes. Meaning if you transform this like here and you hold on Alt again or right click, it will say here transform it to zero. It will take it back to the original spot. And just to keep, you know, original, you know, place, you don't really have to move it anywhere else and you don't know where to place it. Again, hold on Alt, right click and head to transform to zero. So while we're here, you can also do skinning for the lower part, and we will add, we're gonna only add the base here of that sword, which we can only add the base of the sword, that's what control it. But also if you select the handle, if you move everything, should really follows now. And if you go ahead and move this itself, it should also move. And in case, again, you forgot where to put it, hold on Alt, right click on the nodes, and transform to zero. So now we have done the sword skeleton or the structure that we need just to make sure this is going to be built properly. Now what we have to do is you're going to go select this, which is going to be the hand or the handle. Let's go call this IMVU. _ hand controllers. I am not really controls. All right. Now what we want to do is left click and drag this one here. And we can also go here to the wireframe at this point just to get a closer look of what we do. It really depends on which hand do you want this to be placed. For mine, I just want to do it with the right, just to get an easy, you know, reference here. But you can always use whatever hands you want to use it for. And here, while your node is selected, which you can tell by the name that is here, you get a closer look for the bone you want. That's going to be the right hand. And you're going to choose a line and choose, look, left click, and then choose that here. And while we're here, everything should be also centered. What I like to use for this one, I choose, I think pivot point will work, but also turn on all the locals. just Z, Y, and X, and hit OK. And now all you have to do is you're going to move this sword, let me just go on from the side view here, to the hand. Just reposition it. And while we're selecting again the handle, which is control the sword, you can lift this up a little bit and go ahead and pull that down. That actually sword handle, I think, was way too big. But that's fine. We can just play this with this. And just to move it a little bit in here to see where the hands turn on back to realistic, just to see how the hands and the sword play together. And that might be, I think that's okay. That's fine here. So what you have left is this. So you're going to have to first thing have this guy here linked to the hand or the hand controller, meaning that the sword, anytime the hand will move, which is going to be moving this here, will move the sword according to the movement of this one here. So to do that, there's a couple ways that you can just do it here by left click this one and take it to this, or the easier way, which is what I like, open this up again, and here's the hand controllers, right? So this, if you just, let me show you this in a little better view here. So you go ahead, this is the hand controller, this is the base. I want the base to be linked to this one here. So while we're here, you're gonna go for link or connect. Take it, see that the icon has a change. You're gonna left click here and draw a line to this one, and it'll snaps under it. And then now you can see the line here goes down, meaning this control that, and this one here follows the hand. And that's what we wanted. Let's go ahead and close now this. And we pretty much, all we have to do is we're gonna have to export the mesh. So the first thing we need to do is you select the base of the mesh, which is this one here, the hand controller, and you're gonna go ahead and choose this here, and you're going for export. Well, let's go ahead and choose the file where we're gonna export our folder to, and IMVU. I'm gonna go for a skeleton. So I'm gonna call this Starwars_skeleton. I'm gonna call it 01 just to identify what I actually done here. So I'm gonna go ahead and save. It will give you some sort of a map of what you have here. So we have the IMVU hand controller, the sword controller handle, and then the base and the top. Once everything is checked, you have to be checked. Go ahead and hit OK. Now, it's really important. Let's say you want everybody by that sword, it has to be in closed position. So you have to do is while you're selecting this top, which is the one that controls the sword, come here where it says view, left click once, and go this for locals. It will transform, let's go ahead and choose the select and move. It will make the axis according to the alignment of that sword. So all you have to do now, I choose local, didn't I? Yes. And left click here for the Y axis, and left click and drag it in. That's where everybody gonna buy the sword is gonna be in closed position. And then once we move to IMVU, we can tell the IMVU that there's a trigger word that we're gonna add that make the sword rise again. So while we're here, you're gonna go ahead and select the lower part of the sword and go ahead and export it. And what we do here, we're gonna call it this Star Wars lower. Let me turn off the caps here. Lower base. And again, we're going to change this to be mesh. And remember, we have done the material in the first place, just so we can save our work and just get an easy time with it. We go ahead and save. It will ask you, is it going to be using the same skeleton, which is Star Wars skeleton, which is what we did first, and then we're going to continue yes. Yes. And there we go. Now we're going to also select the top part. And we're going to go from control here, I mean the exporting. And we're going to call this Star Wars top. Let me see. Top. And we can just go and export it. The same setting will be the same. And here we're done. And now all we have to do is we're gonna go try what we have done in 3ds Max. But before we do, we can also do the animation just for now. And then we can save the animation as we want. Then you go and select that node again that controls the top. And here is your timeline just for the animation here. Turn on auto key. And just to make sure you're in the right position, just hit that set key once. And notice here, it write a key down for you that the position of that sword in the first, you know, time of the animation is going to be in that steady, you know, down position. Let's go ahead and take this in maybe 15 frames. And just go ahead and use that Y axis. Take that sword back up. And again, I don't think it'll be a good idea to use it to, like we did, like Alt, right click and transform, because it's probably gonna, okay, yeah, it does. So use Alt, right click, and then choose to transform to zero, which should give you the length of the original sword. Let's go ahead and come back here and see this the sword, you know, rising, and that's what we want. So while we're here, remember this, we have three keyframes from 0 to 15. So all you have to do now is this. Select the original node that controls everything. Right click, and then go ahead and export. Actually, I'm sorry, you're going to have to select the one that at the sword base. That's what we want. So you're going to go ahead and export. And this is going to be the first also key for animation for the next tutorials. And it's a really good idea to learn the animation, how you can play, and how you can do certain bones while you're playing the animation. So we're going to go for the animation here. And we can call this sword rise. And we can go ahead and save. It will be the same skeleton here. And now, while we're here, all you have to do is uncheck everything except for the top. Because the only node that moves here is the top base. Or the top, you know, sword controllers. So while we go here, we're going to go control next. And here, it's not going to be the whole entire timeline. We only have 15 frames. Remember that. So you're going to go ahead and come here, go for 15, and hit finish. Once that done, we can go ahead and now try our sword. You can move to the creator mode, and we're going to choose the new print product. And we're going to come here, which is accessories. Turn that on. And again, is that funny glasses? We can change it. And here, you can add the skeleton that we built. And let me see here if I can. I think it's in desktop. Yes, here. And we're going to go to the IMVU. And the skeleton is here. Notice what happened when I hit apply. It will snap to the arms. But remember, this still a head because here is we have to change it. So you're going to come, try to come here a little closer to the hand. Go to wireframe and select the right hand. All you have to do is right click here, selected, and control and C, or you can use the right click and copy. Come back in here and control V, or you can use the right click and paste. I think control V will work better, and hit OK, and now get to apply that. Again, because this is not really meant, that mesh was not meant for the skeleton that we built. So you can have, can come here now and try to upload the rest of it. So let's go ahead and turn, go add an XMF file, which is going to be the sword lower base. Let's turn that on and see. Notice it snaps to the arms what we wanted it. And then let's go and add our material. Again, that's a 21. And it's going to be pretty much the lower part of our mesh, which is going to be here. And looks pretty good. Then go ahead and turn two faces on, two sided materials. And we can go back for mesh and add the top part. See, if it asks you for 3, don't really make it because we started with 20 as a material. So you can always go for like 22, 23. For some reason, it picks one of the IMVU body parts, which is going to mess up, you know, the entire thing. So you might want to go for 21 and add the top part, add apply. And here, we can go ahead and choose the top material, which is, you may not notice it, but I'm sure, let's try to see if, okay, can't really have it now. There we go. You can see now it's everything been colored. Again, turn two sided materials on, hit apply. And while we're here, you can come and add an action. And that's what we're going to be making the sword rise or not. And I forgot also that we can, so I had to pause the video. I have a problem with the animation for some reason not playing right. So the way I got it right, I did the same thing what I did with the rise of the sword. And I have it from 0 to 15, which is what we have here. I only give it one more frame ahead of the animation just to stay in the play. So let's go ahead and try that. If you do play, notice the sword rise and it stays like that. If you go ahead and just put, you know, the name for the trigger word and make sure this is empty. And when you come here, the actual animation set from 0 to 15, which is what we have here. But this is going to be the loop starting. Even though I don't have a 16 or I have like a one key ahead. So what I did was like the loop start at 15 and add one more frame to it. So it's going to be staying on these two frames, which is not going to be changing anything about the sword. And for the shrink, I have to go back into this max. And when I did, I have to left click over the timeline and get delete all the keyframes and move it back to where it says 0. And I got the original rise position for the sword. And I have the auto key and set a key for it. And move it like 15 keyframes ahead. And then I got it to a lower position. And I give it another two keys to the 17. I also have set key on 17 just to give me another two keys, you know, two frame keys. And what I did was just using the same thing by going to the IMVU header controller, going to export. And go for the shrink here, and once I do, and use the same skeleton, uncheck everything except the top. And here, what I did was like set this again from 0, but instead of going to 15, I make it up to 17. Let's go here and 17, and I hit finish. And once you come here for the shrink, I have to use it and hit apply. Again, make sure replace is on in both of them. And let me see here. So I have only for the shrink going to be play at one time. But then it's going to be staying at an infinite loop from 15 to 17, which is the closing position. So let's go ahead and try this one more time. Here the rise and here is the shrink. And one last thing before we close in here, if you want this sword to actually kind of emit lights, all you have to do is you come here for the material, where the top part of the sword, and let me see, say self-illuminate, and just hit play, or apply changes. And the reason why, if this is going to go up, let me try here, I have a room, I think, to test out this. If you know, let me go ahead and turn delete all the lights that I have here. Let me see. Oh, wow, I got so many here. Notice here, if I hit play, and you can't even tell by itself, it's just already illuminating lights. If I just have the rise, and it's going to be stays on, even though there's nothing else shown in the entire, there's no light. So yeah, this is how you can make it glowing. Let's go ahead and back to this one and see. Let's try this one last time. And this is going to be the rise. And this is going to be the shrink. And I hope this, guys, was very helpful for you. And maybe later on we can add, I'll teach you guys how you can make sound. They're going to be playing with your accessories. And there might be a chance for another tutorial that could come up very soon. Probably in less than a week. I'm trying to make as much as I can before the new year. So, yeah, I hope you guys really enjoyed the tutorial and learned so much from it. And I know the tutorial today is going to be longer than we ever have, but I'm trying to make it as simple as possible. So I hope you guys enjoy it. Leave a comment, leave your likes if you want. I'll appreciate, you know, seeing all the comments for requests for any tutorials. And I'll see you guys on the next video.